Right now, let's talk agri-talk, promoting discourse on agriculture, food security, and agribusiness. We have so far talked about, in the next hour, we'll be talking about tea, we have talked about coffee, we've talked about livestock farming, we've talked about meat. Let's talk about milk. The economics of dairy farming in Kenya. One of the things that, you know, for very many years, like we were talking about the other day, the aggregators that were there in the market, very well-structured Kenya cooperative creameries, where people knew that, you know, I have dairy cows, this is where I'm going to take my milk, and these are going to get paid. And then at some point, now we saw many more companies, dairy companies coming up. So the market expanded. At some point, we saw those who were in the sector telling us that Kenya is actually not even able to meet its own demand for milk. At some point, that Kenya was producing so much that we could even export. At some point, there's a milk glut. At some point, there's milk shortage. So what is it that needs to happen? How much are Kenyan farmers getting per liter of milk? How much are Kenyan farmers inputting to produce 1 liter of milk? Does it make sense? Let's bring in somebody who's an expert in this. His name is David Maina. He's a dairy investment expert and a lead consultant for Performer, talking about economics of dairy farming in Kenya. Good morning, David.
Good morning, Eric. How are you?
Very well, thank you. Welcome to the Situation Room.
Thank you very much. Happy to be here.
Now, we're talking about dairy and the dairy sector. Just before we begin this, for the benefit of everybody, give us a picture of the dairy sector in the country in terms of how much we produce, how much we consume, maybe how many farmers we have, or the best dairy producing area, milk producing area, and such.
Yeah, that's a good background. I think let me just dig straight into that kind of data. The estimation right now is about 5.2 billion liters produced nationally per year, but that is also including milk from goats and camels. So I think we could look at 90% or thereabouts of that coming from cows. Mm-hmm. So say cows would be around 4.2-3 billion liters in a year. But it's also good to make a disclaimer that sometimes our data is also very good estimations, but not very high levels of accuracy. So we could say that this is a working figure. Uh-huh. We have about 4.5 billion heads of livestock. So we have a bigger percentage of beef animals, and others are in between. They are there for beef, but people still, because of their livelihood, they also milk them. Mm-hmm. But in terms of high potential areas, we probably are having about 1 million farmers who are doing dairy at different levels, with a small percentage of them being in the medium level and large scale level. The majority, what we can say, perhaps over 80% would be smallholders, with one cow lactating, the other cow dry, and maybe a calf. You know, that's a typical smallholder in Kenya. Our consumption levels, we look at it better as per capita consumption. Mm-hmm. That's a figure that shows how much does every individual Kenyan consume in a year. It was estimated at 110 liters per person per year in 2010. So there hasn't been other very accurate research to tell us how far we have come, but there are some studies recently that have been putting it at between 120 and 130. The study that was done in 2010 was also projecting that in 2030, we will probably be doubling that. We're looking at going up to 200 liters per person per year. For this data, it's also good to say that it shows that the people who live in the towns consume on average nearly 1.5 to 2 times the amount of milk per year than the rural populations. So there's also a bit of difference, though we report the average Kenyan per capita consumption of milk annually.
Is this per capita consumption met by the production, by what is available? Are we able to actually consume everything that we produce?
I think so far there is a very minimal export. So we can say that all the milk produced in Kenya is being consumed here, with 90% of it going into fresh milk and only about 10% going into value-added products like yogurts, and others. You know that our population is not very much used to highly solidified new products like cheese and so on. Mm. So that's more of a niche market, but a very good indication of the growing market in yogurt and fermented milk, mala or lala. But of course, a lot of our consumption is in fresh milk, where people are taking tea and of course consuming milk fresh. For most of the households, it is the milk used in tea. To answer your question about how does consumption compare with production, in terms of growth percentages, is that our consumption is growing at 7 to 8% per year. Our production is growing at 2 to 3% per year. That is data from Kenya Dairy Board in 2019 or end of 2018. So if you're looking at these graphs in terms of comparing the consumption and the production graph, the trend line is showing that we are moving towards a deficit where we will have to look out for milk from other areas or import milk, whether it is going to be most likely, of course, because of availability, is going to be imported in terms of powder milk. We have to import milk for our people in the next about 5 years. It is very unfortunate, I think.
It is unfortunate, but... since you are an expert in this field, tell us how it is. Well, one, we got into this position where, as you say clearly, we are facing a deficit, which means from time to time we also face this deficit. And secondly, how we can avert this, because it's something that we can foresee.
Yeah. Let me say that it's a major. I guess if there's anybody who is really thinking about this at the strategic level of government, this must be a real headache. Because on one hand, we have a history where we always wait for the processors, the tier one processors, to be able to report to the dairy board how much deficiencies they are having or how much deficit they are having. And that informs the board on whether to get a cabinet memo approved by the cabinet to be able to allow a window of importation. So there has been periods where they project a deficit, then a chance is opened for importation, then it is closed. I'm told that sometimes when it's open, the processors are not actually importing the allowed, they actually import less than what is allowed for importation to be able to service that deficit. So what's happening now is that we might be looking at, instead of having periodical opening, we might have to say in about 5 years, if the trend continues, then we just accept that we normalize the fact that our milk, perhaps half of all the milk we require, is coming from other countries. Now, what is happening at the production level is that there's a lot of burning of fingers by the farmers. And this has nothing to do with the inability of the farmers to do some good dairy farming at their level. It has to do with the right cost of production. So that if the enterprise does not make sense to the farmer, then the farmer does not primarily go to farming to help the country. They go to farming so that they can be able to feed their household. So it matters to them mostly if it can make sense and bring income to them. If it doesn't, then the thought of whether the country will begin to import if I stop farming, that is not for the concern for the farmer. It is for his own viability at the household or at the farm level. So we are likely to see a situation whereby if we continue having rising costs, then we have many farmers dropping off, and then we have government having to think, what do we do? Because we have to feed the country. And that's what I'm calling an unfortunate situation, where we would have to be thinking about importing a basic commodity, which nearly every Kenyan household is using every day.
Allow me to just stick to this point.
Yes.
Are we saying that we are not able to make policy decisions that can ensure that we actually have sufficient milk production in this country?
We can have sufficient milk production. And I can tell you that so far, the production we have, and I think if you have looked at any comparison data, looking at how milk is produced in Africa, Kenya is rated second from South Africa. And in terms of our consumption, I need to say that we are rated the highest per capita in all developing countries globally. So it means that our consumption per capita is very encouraging. It is a huge opportunity for farmers. So even without starting the issue of policy, purely on market demand and supply, our consumption encourages production on its own because farmers can see there is a market. And then also the development of our urban centers, which has been stimulated a lot by devolution, then you see that we have a lot of people beginning to aggregate at the town centers, and we see a projection by FAO that by 2050, we have nearly 50% of all Kenyan population living in the towns or in the cities, and we have the other 50% forming the rural demographic. What that means is that our market prospects continue to increase, and therefore, naturally, they should also continue to encourage production. But now we have a problem right at the core of where production happens. Will a farmer accept to produce if they know they are going to make a loss? Mm-hmm. Let me take you through some information, if you allow me, just to show
Balance, the situation please.
That is dissuades the farmer from actually producing, and what the government must have a headache about, because this is what might drive us to a deficit, even when we are actually capable of producing in terms of skills, in terms of genetics that we have, in terms of climate, the ecological suitability, in terms of dairy farming in most areas in Kenya. If I take you through the numbers, then you will see why I'm saying that we are sitting in a very risky place as far as our prospects for feeding our people is concerned. Now, the food security definition has changed a bit. We no longer think about food security in terms of a household feeding themselves. I think we are now away from that. 30 years ago, 20 years ago, anybody would have thought that for a country to be said to be secure, it is a household ensuring that they can be able to produce food for themselves. But now, as we move towards more settlements in the towns, then you are beginning to think that the food security that now means feeding the people who are not producing. We have 5 million people or more in Nairobi. 90% of those sections in Nairobi, you cannot keep a cow. Perhaps there are some outskirts where dairy farming is happening. Mm. So all these people are consuming mouths, and they have no scope to produce because they are in restricted zones. And now that happens in all other growing towns. So then food security now means feeding that family, but also feeding the people who are in the city. So that is therefore why I will not want to discuss that cow, what you can call the pet cow, which the household keeps to feed themselves. I would rather not look at that.
Yeah.
Let me look at that cow that feeds the farmer only with 10% of the total production, and that farmer has to take 90% of that production to the market.
Mm-hmm.
That is the farmer we must discuss, and that is the farmer who is stressed.
Okay, so if we're looking, David, if we're looking at this now, from a national point of view, whereby a country says that, aside from being food secure, you want to make sure that you provide enough of a certain commodity to feed the country. We're not even talking about exports of certain product. So where should the priority lie then here? Where should the priority lie? Feeding the people or making it for farmers to feed themselves, or making this commodity sufficient for the entire country? Where should the priority lie?
A farmer feeding himself and feeding his household, already we are past that. That was a good narrative for 1980 and perhaps earlier than that. After that, we began to see a lot of rural to urban migration. We have a lot of population, and then with the projection of 50-50 rural to urban demographics, then we know that our production cannot focus anymore on a household feeding itself. You know, people feeding the two parents and their children. That household unit, we are past that. Of course, the government must think about the few Kenyans in some stressed areas where they have to be given food. I'm very sensitive about that. But I'm talking about the farming zone. We must look at them. These 80% of dairy farmers in Kenya must be looked at as the ones who are going to feed the country. So they must produce 80% of their production, must come to be processed and presented to the shelf for the urban population to buy.
But if then I hear, if I can interrupt you, David, then it is absolutely necessary then to make the environment conducive for them to do this supply.
That, exactly. I mean,
a lot of the things that we've heard about imports coming in from countries like Uganda, milk and milk products and even poultry products, is because the cost of production is extremely low. Farm inputs like fertilizers and things like this, farmers can actually afford. So that is why they can afford to sell them at a cheaper price. Now, if we're saying that 80% of farmers in Kenya ought to provide for the national grid, as it were, then that means that their inputs all also must be affordable. Because just like you said, a farmer is not going to say, okay, well, yes, I have a national responsibility and something to provide towards, but I'm not going to take that out of my pocket. If it hurts me, I'm not going to do it. Is that not what we're dealing with?
Yeah, exactly. And I would like to, in fact, why I was driving it towards the point of the outlook of food security changing in all developing nations is that if it was the times of the second president and the first president, those ones had a duty to ensure that every family can feed itself. But now we have to make every farming commercial for anyone who is able, because we are constrained by this huge burden of feeding everybody who is a net consumer and has no scope to produce. I wanted us to look at that commercial side. And for now, because of this discussion, we ignore the pet cow, which is reared just to produce enough for the farmer. That cow, which is even given a name, and people come to pet around her. And now, let's forget about that cow. Let's talk about that cow who is kept to produce 25 liters, and the family is left with 2 liters and has to take to the market 23 liters. Let me guide you through what that cow is, so that we see where we are going wrong. First of all, I begin by saying, in as much as we have made great steps in dairy for the last about 4 decades, we have now this major problem. We have some of the most competitive prices for milk. By the way, for your crew at the studio, let me tell you, our prices are good. Some of the cooperatives are actually paying farmers 43 shillings a liter of milk. And I'm talking about these cooperatives that have been able to move a level higher to process the milk for the farmer and actually do the entire route to market and present the farmer's product to the shelf by themselves, so that the milk goes the whole supply chain in the name of the farmer. Those cooperatives have managed a very good deal, and they are paying farmers attractively. And if you look at 43 shillings a litre, considering that our quality of milk is slightly lower compared to the European or American quality parameters, then that could actually be the best paid milk prices in the world, if you look at it in that respect. But then there's another issue that people don't look at. Farmers don't eat revenue. Farmers eat profit. So no matter how attractive a revenue might look like, Eric, for example, and your colleagues, if you get paid $1 million today as salary, we can celebrate you for how much money you earn in a month. But if your house rent is 900,000 shillings, then when you go back to your house to do your budgeting, you are actually a very financially stressed person, regardless of revenue. Mm-hmm. So here we have a huge, very attractive revenue. If anybody from Netherlands looked at our prices, they would say, you guys are getting better paid than ourselves on average in a year. You're getting 43. We are probably getting about €0.35, which is slightly lower. And our milk is higher quality. And I don't want to delve the quality issue because I don't want to make...
It's about the cost of production. I
don't want to imply that we have bad milk. But let me go straight to the feeding that cow. This cow that is commercial, and we have been able to move away from that pet cow, she is feeding about 5 kgs of napier grass. We have to include napier because that's what farmers have. She'll be feeding about 20 kgs of maize silage for her to produce 25 liters in early lactation. This ratio can of course change when she moves towards calving because her milk production abilities are going to reduce. Then she's also feeding about 11 kgs of dairy meal. Can I surprise you that in the last about 2 years, dairy meal has risen from about 25 shillings a kg. The high yield dairy meal right now is at about 38 shillings a kg. It is becoming impossible to give cows dairy meal. And yet, the kind of genetics we have cannot produce without dairy meal. Dairy meal is what people generally refer to as concentrates. If I want to be a bit technical there, cows eat fodder, which is basically the leaf-based material that they eat, but they also eat the concentrates, which is the non-leaf part of feed.
David, if I may interrupt you at this point, David, I think there's actually a wealth of knowledge that you're beginning to share with us here. And because of time constraints, we may not be able to actually have enough to go with this. Can we say that we invite you again? So are we going straight into the cost of production of milk in this country?
And also talk about quality.
And the quality of the milk being produced in the country as well. So that we then see, does it make sense? What policy interventions are required? What is it that needs to happen? So that then the farmer can be profitable. Because that's the bottom
line. Thank you.
Asante sana, David.
Let me go straight. Let me go straight to the total cost. I was going to speak the elements, but I think it's not because of time. Let me just go to the total. I was going to arrive at a total cost of production of 34 shillings a liter. So, I mean, right now the minimum that has been set is around 33.
Wow.
So if we go by that, then it means a commercial farmer will be making a loss of 1 shilling per cow per day. And therefore, it's from the face value, it's a loss. Now, for the cooperatives that pay 40 shillings, then of course those ones can support a farmer to continue producing. However, those cooperatives have no control on the rising cost of concentrates, have no control on the rising cost of electricity.
All the other inputs.
And all the other costs, including taxes, the government imposing without securing farmer.
That's so very true. That's very true. David, thank you very much. Rising. Thank you very much for today.
Problem there.
Thank you very much for today, David. Asante San. I think we need to have some more time on this conversation, for this conversation, just to get to understand it. David Maina is a dairy investment expert and a lead consultant for Performa. We're talking about the economics of dairy farming in Kenya.